Glory to God. I want to welcome everyone to another one of our lessons on manifested success. We're really studying how to go about manifesting the success that we have manifested in Christ Jesus. We have manifested success. When we got saved, we became successful. I want you to think about that. When we got saved, when we received salvation in Christ Jesus, at that point in time, we were successful. Our life here on earth was a success. Our time here was a success. No one could ever convince me that I'm a failure, because I have succeeded because of the salvation that I have in Christ Jesus. You know, it's a lot of people that need to know that are striving to succeed, striving for success, living their whole lives, when some of them are successful. Those that are saved in Christ Jesus are successful, but they don't realize it because they haven't receive the knowledge of their success in Christ Jesus. They haven't received it, or they haven't accepted it, or they haven't heard it, or they haven't been taught. They haven't studied. For some reason, they don't understand that success and salvation in Christ Jesus are synonymous. Now, if you go about your whole life trying to do what you've already done, you're going to be a frustrated individual. Rather than getting an understanding of your success in Christ Jesus, if you're still trying to succeed, you cannot accomplish anything, because your whole basis and premise is wrong. You're trying to get something you've already got. And if you haven't received salvation in Christ Jesus, that's the first step to success. Now, I shouldn't even say the first step. That is success, finding salvation in Christ Jesus. You say, well, Pastor, what are we studying? We're studying success. We're studying manifesting success. We're studying to learn how to manifest, bring it out to light, where it can be seen, where we can live the experience of the success that we have manifested already in Christ Jesus. Is that confusing to use both of those words? We're trying to manifest, bring it out to where it can be seen, that we have already received, the success that we have already received in Christ Jesus. So what we're doing is manifesting or bringing out. That's what the word manifesting means, to bring out to where it can be seen, by ourselves and by others, the success that we have that was, past tense, manifested when we received salvation. And this is part of God's plan. Unfortunately, not just unfortunately, but almost tragically, so many have been caught up in religion. And religion keeps a person from realizing the success that they have gained in Christ Jesus when they got saved. Religion focuses a person on their activities, physical activities, mental activities, social activities, just on their actions, what they're doing. Religion wants a person to base their success, their acceptance by God, on whether they're being sinful or not sinful, whether they're living a good life or a bad life. Religion wants a person to focus God's blessings and gifts on the individual's obedience or disobedience to what was known as the law or the Ten Commandments, or base it upon the actions of the person, not on the love of God. The success that we have manifested in Christ Jesus is because of the love of God, our Father, the love of our Lord Jesus, and the love of the Holy Spirit. The love that God has for us was manifested in and through our salvation in Christ Jesus. Now that we have the salvation, now that we have the manifested success in our salvation, God now wants to teach us how to take this that we have internally and bring it out to the external where it can be seen by others. We are a spirit. And if our spirit is saved, how long are we saved for? All of eternity. And our salvation, and so many believers, and we know also so many believers believe that their success, their acceptance by God is based upon their actions. When it's all based upon God's love for us, the very love of God. Now, we would say that we know that the scripture says that, what does it say there in James? The only thing in the world is the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life. That's the only thing in the world. And when we look at Adam and Eve in the garden, they fell because of those three things. Let's go back and see if we can see any of this in Genesis. We want to expose Satan's lie that he perpetrates through religion so that we can help to set others free. We can free ourselves and help to set others free. And in chapter 3, in verse 6, it says, "And when the woman saw the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes." So the woman did what? The lust of the eyes. She saw something. This looks good to her. And that's what we do today. Man still does the same thing. The only thing in the world is the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh. He said, "And the woman saw the tree was good for what? Food." You'd think that they were starving if you think about this. Was there other food around? Was this the only thing that there was there to eat? How many trees and how many different types of fruit? This is one tree out of all the fruit-bearing trees. She saw this was good for food, the lust of the flesh. I wonder what that tastes like. So she's using her eyes, and her body is lusting after this. And it goes on, it says, "And a tree to be desired to make one wise." That's the pride of life. So if we eat that, we'll be as smart as God. We'll be like God. This is what Adam and Eve, he's right there with her when she's saying this. I'm sure they're discussing it. "Hey, Adam, look at that tree. Boy, doesn't that look good? I bet you that tastes really good. You know, we can eat all this other fruit, but that one right there, oh man, I bet that's some good fruit. And if you eat it, it'll make you wise. That serpent told me. Now, who are they believing? They're believing the serpent. Didn't the serpent tell her that if you eat of that tree, you'll be where in the verse 5, the verse right before, for God does know that the day you eat thereof, then your eyes will be open and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Man, this is going to change your whole life. This thing is, this fruit here, if you eat this fruit, if you get this, if you get that car, if you get this woman, you get that man, you're going to really have it going on. This is Satan's lie. We already have it going on if we have salvation in Christ Jesus. Did Adam and Eve already have it going on? Yeah. They got gold, they got rubies and diamonds and a garden that was planted for them and walking and talking with God their Father every day. And I mean, they had it going on. Like Noah, yeah, like no other man, because there were no other men. But I want this to be something that we relate to ourselves. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. So religion takes this the same way that Satan used this in the garden, he uses it today. Don't you know if you had that, if you did this, you would be successful? If you had that, man, look at what people would think about you, the pride of life. How good would that be? And religion takes that Satan is using, and it says, well, if you'll stop doing, so here's Satan tempting you with what? The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And then religion is condemning you for doing the same thing that Adam and Eve did. They fell to the temptation. Now, is man going to fall to the temptation today? Come on, you guys. Is man going to fall to the temptation today? Yes. He's in less of a position not to fall. The unregenerated man, the man that's not saved, is in less has less ability not to fall than Adam and Eve did. Because we have a fallen nature. So when the temptation comes, is man going to fall? Yes, he's going to fall. So religion comes in and says, oh, you know what you did, you know how you are. God's not going to bless you if you live this way or if you live that way. Religion comes in and tries to get you to believe that the religion is the answer to the condition that the man has fallen to. Come back here to our meetings and you need to confess and you need to do this and you need to do that, and then you can get the blessings in life that you want. But as man, is he in any better position not to fall after hearing that message and after trying to be good? Is he in any stronger position? No, he has a law in front of him that he's going to break again and again and again and again. It's a terrible thing. And people, after they get saved, they fall prey to this same religion that has them constantly on a treadmill, going no place. Now, does God want us living any old kind of way? No. Is that plain? No. God does not want us living any old kind of way, doing anything that comes to mind. Does he know that we will do that? Yes, he does. Did he send his son to pay the price, the penalty for us doing that. Yes, he did. He sent his son to pay the price before we committed the sin. And it's real interesting how you can go to a church and any church teaching this works mentality, you could get them in unison to decree that God has forgiven all of our sins. Our past sins, our present sins, our future sins. It's confusion set up by Satan. They know this intellectually, or at least they've memorized it. Oh, Jesus paid for all of our sins. Then what's going to happen if you go out and do this? Well, you're going to go to hell. So the payment, according to them, then had to be made with a bad check. It didn't take. It's not going to keep you saved. It's not going to keep you in the love of God. Because here I'm going over and over and over again, trying not to do what God knew that I couldn't stop doing. So he sent his son to pay for me doing it. And then he set up a system so that I could stop doing it. But it wasn't by my self-effort. Are you guys getting a picture of this? God knew that religion would come in. He knew all of these things. He could look down and see the plight that man was going to be in. So he had to have a way. If he doesn't want us living like that, then he has to provide a way to keep us, that we can keep from living any old kind of way. Doesn't that seem like our God? Just right, that he's not going to leave us in this plight. That we can't stop sinning, so he sent his son to die for us, and then we go on sinning, and he doesn't care. Well, he does care. His son died because of these sins. And he provided a way for us to escape the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. Unfortunately, religion has focused on, it's not unfortunately, really it's tragically, that religion has focused on us trying to obey those laws to gain the favor of God. Well, if we could obey the laws to gain the favor of God, God was cruel to punish and to sacrifice his son for something we could have done on our own. But he's not cruel and he's not foolish. So here we have the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. So what did he provide us as a means of escaping this that religion tries to keep us so caught up in? Can you guys, does it come to mind? Jesus is the sacrifice. All of that's been taken care of. And Jesus, well, the right answer is always Jesus. But how did he give us any mechanics of how we can go about and overcome? See, the strength of our will didn't do it because it's applying to our soul realm. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. All three of those are really in the soul realm. So what did God do? Because he loves us just like we are. But he doesn't want us to stay like we are. He made it very plain what he did so that we don't fall prey to the lust. Okay. He gave us the ability.